All right. So I guess that's you. Hello, everyone. We've been working with Sarkhan about something that's very fundamental but often overlooked, which is an important to the unsolvability. Those are concepts for infinite and finite groups altogether. And also, they have the related concepts called Frattini subgroups. This is for an importancy, of course. And in finite case, we know quite a bit about Frattini subgroups and importancy and solvability altogether. So Sarkhan will give a presentation about, first of all, what is an important unsolvable, and then what is a Frattini subgroup, and in finite case, why it's so easy to understand. There you go. Thank you, Sarkhan. You can start.
Hello everyone. Today I'm going to talk about Frattini subgroups and its nilpotency in finite groups. First of all, I'm going to talk about composition series, and then I'm going to introduce the central series. And using this central series, I will define nilpotent and solvable groups. And then after all of this, I will define Frattini subgroups and prove their nilpotency, which will be my main goal. We begin with a definition and consider a finite sequence of subgroups of a group G. We are starting from the identity, which is equal to G0, up to GR, which is equal to G. If successive subgroups are known in each other, then the factor group, we can talk about the factor group. The factor group is called the factor of the series. And a second series is called a refinement if all of these, each term in the first series also occurring in the second series. A series like this is called subnormal if I minus one is normal in GE for all I. And a subnormal series is called normal if GR is normal in G. This is a stronger property than the first one because if GR is normal in G, then of course the subnormality is holding. An undefinable subnormal series with no repetition is called a composition series. So, what do we mean by undefinable? Means that you cannot plug any more subgroups to this series. Every finite group G has a composition series in abelian case. Every factor of this composition series has a prime order because if it's not prime, then it is not simple. So if it is prime, then it is simple. So it is undefinable. And Jordan-Hölder theorem states that any two composition series for a finite group G, for a fixed finite group G, are equivalent and they are isomorphic. Here I have some examples. If G is simple and it has no normal subgroup other than identity and itself. So the only composition series for a simple group is that. And a composition series for dihedral group 6 is this one. And there are also other composition series for D6, but like Jordan-Hölder theorem states that they are equivalent up there. And I have a composition series for a symmetric group SN. You know that AN is normal in SN and AN is simple for N bigger than 5. So this will be the only composition series for SN. Here I have a definition. In a group, the commutator of X and Y in G is defined as X inverse Y, Y inverse XY, and the commutator of two subgroups H and K is defined to be commutator of subgroup generated by H and K, such that H in H and K in K. In a group G, the center and the commutator play some important roles. We know that commutator of if we have a group that is commutative, then the center is equal to all of the group. And if group is commutative, then the commutator subgroup of G and G is equal to identity because these will commute. So we will have the identity. And every subgroup of G that is contained in the center, we know that it is abelian, but the converse is not true. Not every abelian group is contained in the center. And in a group, a measure of how close G to be abelian is based on how close the center is G and commutator of G and G to identity. Normal series is called central if for each I, GI plus 1 over GI is contained in center. So, like I said, it implies that it is abelian, but not converse. Equivalently, there's another characterization of central series. The commutator of G and Gi plus 1 is a subgroup of Gi. So there is also another definition, which is defined by induction. There's also another definition similar to that, but look at for the bracket. I will use bracket G0 to G set, G1 to G prime, that is the commutator of G and G. And by induction, Gi plus 1 is the commutator of Gi, Gi. These sequence of subgroups of GIN is called a derived series. And there is also another definition. This is without brackets. G0 equal to G, Gi plus 1 equals G and Gi, commutator of G and Gi. That's the difference between above. This is called the, this sequence of subgroups is called the lower central series. And for all in natural numbers, following statements are true. These subgroups are normal in G. They are descending. They are descending. They are trying to. We are starting from the whole group, and we are trying to reach the identity. Let's see if we can. And the factor is abelian, and there is also this. Here are some examples. If G is abelian, then G prime, the commutator of G and G, is equal to identity, because all of the elements will commute. So we will have the identity. If G is equal to the ideal group N, then G prime is equal to subgroup generated by R square, which is abelian, since it is a cyclic group. So G prime prime equal to identity. If we consider alternating group for N is bigger than phi, alternating group does not have any, you know, that does not have any normal subgroup, but we said that it is normal. So it will be An prime is equal to An. For by induction, for all I, it's equal to An. So the central derived series for An does not reach identity. Like I said, we are trying to investigate if it can reach identity or not. So this example does not reach identity. You can also consider Sn, G prime, the commutator of Sn and Sn equal to An by previous example. It's also not reaching identity. Here I have some other examples for the lower central series. G1 to identity if G is abelian. And the same for the alternating group, An prime, which is the defined same as the derived series for beginning. An prime equal An, thus by induction, An to the I equal to An for all I. And so lower central series does not reach identity. And there's the same for the symmetric group, G prime equals G1, the commutator of Sn and Sn equals to An. Therefore, Sn to I does not also reach identity. There's a remark. These series may not form a normal series, because in order to form a normal series, we are beginning from a group and we are trying to reach the identity. But these, like as you can see, they are not reaching identity, so they may not reach, they may not form a normal series. Here I have also another definition, the ith center, which is quite hard to understand. But we are beginning from the identity this time. Control on the, we said Z0 to 1. If we know what Zig to is, we define the natural homomorphism from G to G over Zi, and set Zi plus 1 to be the pre-image of the center of the G over Zi. So it is quite somewhat, but you can notice Zi plus 1 is can be defined in this way. And if you set I equals 1, we get Z1 equal to center of the group. So we are starting from the identity, and at the second step, we will get the center of the group. And this is also another definition, Zi plus 1 over Zi equals the center of the G over Zi. And lower central series, we have lower and upper central series. One is starting from the bottom, the other is starting from the top. they are trying to reach their target. One of them tries to go up, one of them tries to go down. So they reach their target at the same time, at, for the same i. So zi equals g if and only if gi equal to 1 for some i. And if they can reach their target, we call g is nilpotent. These are some equivalent conditions. G has a central series. Gi equal to 1 for some I, Zi equal to G for some I. And the smallest E satisfying this is called the nilpotency class of G. Some authors say that this is half bar G from being abelian, I guess. Something like that. And there's also another definition. A group G is called solvable if its derived series reaches the identity. So I have three series, one of them is lower, upper central and lower central, and derived series. Lower and upper central series are defined for nilpotency, and the derived series is defined for solvable. And we can, this is a theorem very easy to prove. Every nilpotent group is solvable because in order to be a solvable, it needs to be a normal series, and it needs to be contained in the center. So it is contained in the center, so it is abelian. Since it is abelian, it has a subnormal series with abelian factors, just from the definition. Here I have a theorem. All abelian groups are nilpotent because if you can consider the center, the center will be equal to G. So higher center series will reach to G at 1 with class 1. All finite P groups are nilpotent, and some authors consider nilpotent groups are as generalized P groups. A subgroup of a nilpotent group is nilpotent, and so nilpotency is closed under subgroups and direct products and quotients. And using this theorem, I have a corollary. If H and K are normal subgroups of G, such that G over K and G over H are nilpotent, so their direct product is also nilpotent. So their direct product, you know, the isomorphism theorem. So this will be the nilpotent part of the theorem. And here I have nine equivalent conditions up to nilpotency. If G is nilpotent, we know that the second and third conditions, and fourth condition states that if H is a proper subgroup of G, then H is contained properly in its normalizer in G. All subgroups of G are subnormal in G, so that means that there is a subnormal series from starting from the H and reaches to G. All maximal subgroups of G are normal in G. All zero subgroups of G are normal in G. G is isomorphic to not to the to a direct product of its zero subgroups. And what is surprising me is this condition: if A and B in G, such that their order is relatively prime, then A and B commute in G. If this statement is true, then G is nilpotent. I was very surprised when I saw this. So using this, finally, I will define Frattini subgroups. Frattini subgroups for a given group G is defined to be the intersection of all of its maximal subgroups. As you can say, maybe you can take it's not, it doesn't have any maximal subgroups, then we set phi g to equal to g. For example, phi a5 alternating group is equal to identity, and same for the symmetric group, because in symmetric group all maximal subgroups are permutation that fixes one element, one point, so they intersection will be trivial. So same for the symmetric group. Set of rational number does not have any maximal subgroups, so Frattini subgroup of rational numbers equals to rational numbers. And third example is that dihedral group of four equals to subgroup generated by R square. This is harder to second first two, but dihedral group does not always not always a nilpotent group. It is nilpotent if and only if this subscript is a power of 2. It's something like 2 to the k. If it's nilpotent, only if it's a power of 2. And here I have also a little definition. An element A of G is called a non-generator if there's a set, if whenever a set generates G, if you take A out of this set, then this set also generates G. For example, if the order of G is bigger than 1, then 1 is a non-generator of G, because you can, if you take 1 out of a set, then multiplying and generating these elements, you can always get G. There is also another theorem. For all finite groups G, the set of all non-generators equals the Frattini subgroup of G. And here I have a proof, but I don't think time will allow me to. So I will just skip the proof. For any group G, Frattini subgroup is known. So we know by the correspondence theorem that if I have a maximal subgroup, then any homomorphic image of a maximal subgroup is maximal. So any automorphism of a maximal subgroup is maximal. So then we can take intersection, and it is true for all automorphism. So it is true for inner automorphism, and inner automorphism of the Frattini subgroup is ending up in Frattini subgroup. So Frattini subgroup is known. That's a very simple group. And there is also another more stronger property. Frattini subgroup is characteristic in G. So this means that any automorphism of the Frattini subgroup end up in Frattini subgroup. Here I have a Frattini argument. If G is finite group and K is a normal subgroup, and if P a pseudo subgroup of G, then G equals normalized of P in G K. And also another lemma: if G is finite and H is a subgroup of G, and if G equals H P G, then H equals to G. And using these two lemma, I will prove what I have said in the beginning of this talk. Frattini subgroup is known. I'm sorry, nilpotent. So there was like 8 equivalent conditions up to nilpotency. So I will use the following. All pseudo subgroups of Frattini subgroup are normal in Frattini subgroup. So if Frattini subgroup equals to it's trivial, then there is nothing to prove. So suppose it's not trivial, and P a non-trivial pseudo subgroup of Frattini subgroup. Using Frattini argument, which states that if K is normal in G, then normalizer of G in P, K equals G. So since Frattini subgroup is normal, I can use Frattini subgroup instead of K because of this. Now applying the previous lemma, was saying that if G equals HPG, then H is equal to G. So we have G equals normalizer of T in G, PG. So by the previous lemma, normalizer of P in G equals to G, which means that P is normal in G. Since this is true for all pseudo subgroups of PG, we can say that PG is nilpotent. So that was my main theorem. And there are also another two theorem. In general, there's a theorem in solubility. If it states that G is soluble if and only if a normal subgroup and the quotient group is soluble. But in nilpotent group, this is not true in general. For example, you can consider S3. We know that alternating group is normal. So alternating group, and we know that alternating group 3 is nilpotent, and SH over A3 is nilpotent, but SH S3 is not nilpotent. So this is a counterexample. But there's a good characterization of this. If G is finite, then G is nilpotent if and only if G over PG is nilpotent. But unlike, like I said, unlike solubility, this does not true for nilpotent. And there's also another theorem. If G is finite, then G is nilpotent if and only if G prime is contained in the Frattini subgroup. So that's all, I guess. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Any questions or remarks?
I have some